I'm pleased to welcome all of you to today's of the Advisory Committee on Supply Chain Competitiveness. For ACSCC members and speakers, you are welcome to be on camera. For all others, please do not be on camera for the meeting. We're trying to save as much bandwidth as possible. Also, for anyone that is not speaking, please put yourself on mute when you are not speaking so that we can all hear the speakers. And make sure that your name appears on when you signed in so that we can account for everyone that attended today. As the advisory committee specifically established to provide the secretary with advice on supply chain issues, the ACSCC's work is instrumental to our efforts to implement short-term and long-term solutions to address supply chain congestion and related economic challenges. Although some of our supply chain woes and congestion in freight movement on US roads and rails and through ports seem to have eased since mid-2022, there is still a lot of work to be done to ensure supply chain resiliency in the United States. I would like to thank our ACSCC members and our two chairs, Ursula Burns and Jeff Wilkie, for their continued dedication to this effort. We are also excited to welcome our 5 new members. Thank you all for being here. In addition, I'd like to thank Richard Bull, the designated federal officer for this committee, and the entire supply chain team in my office for their hard work in putting all of this together. Is Mima on? If I can introduce her. Jeff, I'm gonna hand it over to you and I'll go to Mima later.
It sounds good, Heather. Well, welcome everyone. I'm Jeff Wilkie. I'm delighted to be a part of this committee and I look forward to what we're gonna hear today from a number of speakers and from the subcommittees that have been working so hard since the last meeting. As Heather said, if you're not on the committee or a speaker, please mute your microphone and turn off your video to save bandwidth. So our committee's objective remains the same as when it was constituted really in the beginning of the, or in the middle of the supply chain crisis that we faced 18 months ago or so. It's to gather experts from business, labor, academia and government to examine deeply the complicated system that moves physical goods from manufacturing locations, wherever they are in the world, including increasingly here in the US, to homes, businesses, governments, and nonprofits across our nation and through exports across the world. We're working to characterize the system, to reduce variability, and to decide where we want the bottlenecks to be. As I said in the very first of these meetings, I have a particular approach to operational strategy that I like to use, which is you have a strategy when you choose the bottleneck. When the bottleneck surprises you and reveals itself to you over time, you don't really have the kind of strategy that's robust. So we want to decide where we're going to spend our money and choose where the bottlenecks will be as a nation. And so part of what we expect to do with these subcommittees and committee are to propose changes for government and industry that will allow us to increase the supply chain performance and resilience, again, by choosing where we expect the capacity limitations to be. After our last meeting on October 12th, we agreed that while we're working to refine a number of recommendations, the following are our top priorities for our committee, and I'll just read these off for the audience. First, we expect to refine a series of workforce recommendations. We'll hear a few of those today, including additional work visa allocations for very highly skilled and educated immigrant students in key advanced manufacturing fields. We want to develop and upgrade US small and medium printed circuit board manufacturing, fill holes in the government's database of total supply and demand for critical minerals and metals, leverage the FDA's supply chain visibility to expand US resiliency strategy and pharmaceuticals, distribute funding in a timely and transparent manner from both IRA and IIJA, and Gene Sirocco will have some thoughts on that subject a little bit later. We want to accelerate the end-to-end supply chain data sharing. This will be a key focus of the data subcommittee going forward, and in subsequent meetings, we'll have more to say about this. We want to identify and prioritize existing and potential export markets for US agriculture and manufacturing. Gene's been beating this drum since the beginning of the freight subcommittee meetings, and it's an important one. And then we want to support implementation of the Ocean Shipping Reform Act in a manner that supports export growth while maintaining supply chain fluidity. So those are in working with the all of the constituents and the Department of Commerce. These are the top areas of focus, although we have recommendations in addition to these, some of which we'll share today. And we'll continue to look for ways that we could narrow down our focus, but also recommend that the government, starting with the Department of Commerce, pay attention to as we uncover them through our work. So we've already, Heather mentioned that we have five new members. Again, welcome. We're excited to have you participate and bring your experiences and skills to these to this dialogue. I'd like to we're in a transition in the data subcommittee, and I really want to thank Hao Li for his service as the chair and as a continuing his continuing service as a member of the ACSCC. So in partnership with the subcommittee chairs, my co-chair Ursula. Ursula, are you on?
She is not.
Okay, I'm not sure. She had a conflict today, so which is okay. But in partnership with Ursula and the committee chairs and all of the committee members, I look forward to continuing to refine our key recommendations and finding ways to add significant value to the Department of Commerce's efforts on behalf of our nation. That's the key for this. We all want this to add value for the work that we do, and add value for the Department of Commerce and for our government. So with that, I think, is Nima on?
Yes, I'm here. Thank you so much. Sorry for the technical difficulties to join a couple minutes late.
That's okay, Nima. If you don't mind, I'll do a brief introduction.
Sure, that would be great.
Okay, try not to embarrass you too much. So Nima Singh Giuliani is the Deputy Assistant Secretary for Services. In this role, she directs the U.S. the Department of Commerce's efforts to create the policy conditions for U.S. digital, financial, supply chain, and other service industries to compete around the world. She's a lawyer and policy expert who has worked on issues at the intersection of national security, economics, and civil rights. Before joining ITA, she served at Twitter as head of national security, democracy, and civil rights public policy for the Americas, where she led development of policy and strategy in the US for surveillance, the open internet, and civil rights.
Thank you so much for that very generous welcome. As Jeff mentioned, Nima Singh Giuliani, the new Deputy Assistant Secretary for Services at ITA. And I lead, you know, services three offices. One of those includes the Office of Supply Chain Professional and Business Services, which is the excellent team that I know you all have worked with. They help to manage this committee. I also lead the Office of Digital Service Industries and the Office of Finance and Insurance Industries. So I'm very lucky and pleased to be joining Assistant Secretary Harris and Secretary Raimondo today. You'll hear from them both directly in just a few moments. But you know, as Jeff mentioned, today we're welcoming five new members. So I just wanna take a brief moment to introduce them. We have Cindy Elliott, the Director of the Business Industry Sector and Corporate Responsibility Lead at the Environmental Science Research Institute. We have Ian Jeffries, the President and CEO of the Association of American Railroads. We have Michael Mullen, the Executive Director at the Express Association of America. We have Ernest Nicholas, the Chief Supply Chain Officer at HP Inc. And we have Stu Pan, the Senior Vice President and General Manager of the Corporate Planning Group at the Intel Corporation. These five members were chosen for many reasons, but among those is their deep expertise that they bring to rail, express delivery, high-tech manufacturing, and supply chain data and technology. We're very, very lucky to have you. I welcome you and thank you for your willingness to serve on the committee. I also wanted to take a minute to briefly emphasize a message that I'm sure you've heard before from my team, and you'll hear from some of the other speakers on the call. And that's that strengthening supply chains is a key priority, both for the Biden-Harris administration and the Department of Commerce. And while I just joined the department a couple of weeks ago, it was clear to me on day one. On day one, it was clear there's a large amount of thinking, a vast amount of resources that are being deployed to address some of these many challenges. And one of my key priorities as the desk for services will be working to support these overall efforts. So I'll just close by, you know, by offering a moment of gratitude. Thank you all for the work that you do. You bring a tremendous amount of experience. Your input has been extremely valuable to the teams working across the government to solve some of these very tough challenges. And I really very much looking forward to working with you, hearing your input about some of the key priorities, some of which I know have already been discussed, and also just ensuring that we have a productive partnership between this committee and the department. So I'll now hand things over to Assistant Secretary Harris.
Great. Thank you so much, Nima. Jeff, everyone for joining, really appreciate it. We value your time and we really value your service on this committee. You've heard us say this before, but it needs to be repeated every time. This is a really incredible form of public service, and to get your insights and recommendations directly is vital for our work to understand how you're seeing the markets, how you're seeing industry, what you're experiencing, and what your recommendations are for how we can be a strong partner and moving forward on these shared concerns is really critical. And we couldn't do this work without it. So I know the secretary will be joining us in a minute. I just wanted to emphasize this point, especially, and Jeff and Ursula and everyone who's involved in the subcommittees, we've really appreciated the ongoing conversation about what your priorities are and how we're seeing what we can move quickly on and what we're refining and what we're doing. I think it's a really important ongoing conversation to have. It's very useful to get that constant feedback, especially as the situation changes since the time that the committee was incorporated in this iteration. And as the supply chain challenges may look somewhat different, and as some have evolved and others are pernicious and sticking with us. So we really respect and appreciate this openness and ongoing work on the shared priorities. A key part of that, as well as a responsibility on our part to make sure you've got visibility into the things that we're doing and that we're seeing as well. And with Jeff and Ursula and through them understanding from the subcommittees, I think we've got an exciting set of speakers for the subcommittees to come have a more in-depth conversation in addition to today's dialogue. And I hope that will be really useful in getting a firsthand sense with at a more granular level on those priorities that you mentioned, Jeff, whether it's critical minerals or some of the manufacturing components and everything in between, what the administration is doing, how your recommendations have been influencing the thinking and the work, and how that real-time give and take is so valuable. So I want to join Jeff in welcoming the new Deputy Assistant Secretary for Services, Nima. It's fantastic to have you on the team, and the new members to the committee here. We really welcome you into the fold and are appreciative of the time commitment that you're putting into this as well. And Jeff and Ursula, of course, for your ongoing leadership and the time involved there. So we remain as focused as ever on this. I know the secretary will be joining us momentarily, but this committee seems to be so efficient every time. We seem to always beat her to the time slot. So rather than belabor everything that I've just said, if there are any questions or comments so far before the secretary joins that I can be helpful on, I'd be happy to do that here. And I'm also happy to come speak with the subcommittees and do anything I can else that I can to support.
Brian? Secretary Harris, sorry, go ahead.
I was wondering who's responsible for monitoring the implementation?
The implementation of the
recommendations.
Yeah, that's in our office here. We've got the team that is the designated federal officer and the go-to connectivity with the committee. And so we've got the recommendations where we've been looking back at them constantly. We've also been talking with Monica Gorman and White House colleagues and figuring out how we can move forward on some of those that touch on other departments and agencies that are beyond the purview of the commerce. And how we've been approaching this is, where are these core issues, particularly now, like critical minerals, for instance, how do we carry that conversation forward? In addition to the recommendations from June, how do we be reading out what, or how can we read out what is happening now with our advanced battery initiatives, with the work that's going on in this space, with the investments that Department of Defense are making, et cetera. And a way that we've been wanting to do that too is ask a White House speaker to come to the subcommittee to brief in more depth about critical minerals, to have a more real-time conversation on it. So we have a more formal track where with these recommendations, we're trying to work as quickly as possible through the interagency, but we're also recognizing that the administration has been factoring these in much less formally as well. We have our formal meetings here every few months, but we also have our internal conversation where we are hearkening back to them and constantly trying to figure out how we can be doing more on them. So it influences our priorities, frankly, in a lot of ways that you don't see day to day, knowing that it's of concern to you, knowing that you're recommending something with the stockpile or recommending X, Y, or Z from what was there. So we've got a formal dialogue, and I think through the subcommittees, we've got a chance actually to really dig in much more deeper in a dynamic way too.
Hey, hi Grant, this is Rich. I think Secretary Raimondo is on.
Great, thanks for letting me know. So I have the pleasure of introducing someone who needs zero introduction, which makes this job as easy as possible and one that I still might fail at, but is generally able to perform introducing someone who you already know. Secretary Raimondo has been clear to us that supply chains remain a persistent priority. I don't want to take any time from her and your discussion with her. So without further ado, Secretary Raimondo, thank you for joining us.
Hello, everybody. Nice to see you all. And thank you, Grant. And thank you to our fearless leaders, Ursula and Jeff. You guys have been great in doing this. And thanks to the speakers. And thank you to all of you. I think we've come a long way as I'm looking around the Zoom box. When I think about the first discussions I had with many of you around supply chains, I feel like we've come a long way in, first of all, unclogging our supply chains, but understanding our supply chains. And a lot of it is due to the work that we've done together. So I want to thank you for that. I'm looking forward to the work that you're going to do around data innovation and technology. That was something that you put on my radar early on. Frankly, it's something I think the US government has a lot of room to improve. And so I'm particularly eager to get your recommendations on supply chain data needs and visibility. I think, there'll be another COVID-like episode. I hope not, but we have to plan as though there may be. And if it's not as big, it'll be similar. So we need these early indicators of supply chain bottlenecks. We have to get much better at our predictive analytics. We in the government and in industry, I've spoken to so many CEOs in the past 12 to 18 months who themselves have said they didn't have a very sophisticated picture of their own supply chains. They didn't have a very sophisticated, detailed picture of the vulnerabilities in their supply chains. So I'm particularly excited about the work to come around data that you'll be doing. Before we get into the discussion and the Q&A, I just wanted to highlight two things that the department is working on that are particularly relevant to the work of this group. The first is in a couple of weeks, we will be releasing the application for semiconductor companies to apply for subsidy from the Department of Commerce. We're targeting February 28th as the date that we'll put that application out. That'll be on or about February 28th. And that the first round of funding will go to big semiconductor fabs. So anyone who wants to apply for a subsidy for a fab, that will happen. Shortly thereafter, a few months thereafter, we will be putting out the application for supply chain companies, because the whole plan here at the end of the day is we want to create several clusters, probably two clusters of advanced semiconductors, which is to say the leading edge fabs and then the supply chain ecosystem around that. We want to create an advanced memory cluster and then mature node clusters. So I'm just putting this on your radar because it matters to the work you're doing at the department. I'm building a team I'll probably, in the end, hire about 100 people to do all this work. I'm bringing in project managers, financial officers, subject matter experts. And first step is the big fabs, and then shortly thereafter, the supply chain. Second, I wanted to again remind you and ask you to think about, in the context of this work, the work that we are doing on the Indo-Pacific Economic Framework. I've spoken with you individually about this. I think I talked about it at this last meeting. As part of our effort to shore up our economic relationships in the Indo-Pacific, and quite frankly, to have those countries be closer to America, a bit of a hedge against China, we are in the process of doing government-to-government agreements with 13 countries in the Indo-Pacific with the United States around four areas: digital and technology, supply chains, tax and anti-corruption, infrastructure, and decarbonization. I'm headed to India in a few weeks. India is an IPEF partner. I'll be going later in the year to other, possibly Indonesia, Malaysia, heading over to Japan. That region is so important as it relates to our supply chains. And I've talked to so many companies who are saying they're over time looking to become less dependent on China and thinking about India, Indonesia, Vietnam. That's good for American national security. That's good for our supply chain resiliency. And I think it's good for America's economy. So I just want to, I suppose, remind you that I am playing a huge role in standing up this Indo-Pacific Economic Framework. There is a supply chain pillar. And I just want to ask you to continue thinking about that and engaging on that in your work here as we make progress on it. So I'll just end by saying thank you. This work's super important. Yeah, I think you're doing great work, by the way. I appreciate it. And I'll just, I suppose, turn it back over to you, Grant, to help us moderate a discussion.
Great. Thank you. And Jeff, we'd love your help as well. We'd love, with your assistance, getting any questions or any topics of conversation for the secretary. Gene?
Gene's got one, yeah.
Great.
Thanks, Secretary. Appreciate you joining today. A lot we can talk about, obviously. Couple things. When you hosted the IPEF meeting here in Los Angeles, India was the lone holdout to sign on. And I know that Minister Goyal has a lot of ideas and a lot of preparation. Do you see them coming on board a little more quickly than maybe some have opined outside of the inner circle in this discussion?
Yeah, nice to see you, Gene. I do. So since that time that I saw you, we've made a huge amount of progress with India. They have signed on to three out of the four pillars. We still have not gotten them to sign on to the digital pillar, but they have signed on to supply chains, tax anti-corruption, and infrastructure and decarbonization. And in fact, I'm about to bring somebody onto my team here, a very seasoned investor, and I'll introduce him to this committee once he's on board, to work just on the supply chain component with an emphasis on India and also Indonesia and Vietnam. I would love feedback from this group, but I think that India is an increasingly attractive place for US supply chain. They have a lot of work to do. The government could screw it up, but for a lot of reasons, they're looking really excellent right now. And it's an area that we plan to spend a lot of time on.
Excellent. Second piece real quick, and we'll raise this with Mayor Landrieu when he comes on later this morning. We've talked a lot about in the past that federal investment has been heavily skewed with respect to ports and supply chain to the East and Gulf Coast. And while we don't want to take any money away from our friends in those locations, Barbara included, we're starting to see the same trending on the IIJAs. Of some 33 construction projects thus far, only two have been designated on the West Coast. So as you continue to work with your cabinet members and others, we're going to make a push to make sure we start to see some awareness around how we can see that share of investment push out. And I know we want to go to red states and battleground states, et cetera, but we've got to take care of where the density of cargo flow happens.
Okay, let me say a few things. You should absolutely put that on Mitch's radar. I will as well. And I will talk to Pete Buttigieg. I also want to say, we should not be thinking about red state, blue state. When I'm managing my team for our money, you know, the broadband money, the CHIPS money, we have $6 billion of climate money. This stuff can't be political. It should not be political. It has to go where the need is. In your case, ports. What are the critical ports? Where are the needs? Where do we put the money? So I'm not deeply involved in those investments, but the decisions haven't been made. There's still plenty of time to raise your hand where the money should go. So now's the time to raise the flag.
Good. Thank you, Secretary.
Thanks, Gene. Maybe Revathi? And then we get Michael.
Thanks, Jeff. Good morning, Secretary Armanda. Good to see you again. I was excited to hear your comments on the CHIP Act and thinking about the rest of the supply chain, because like Gene, I'm going to put a shameless plug in here for this conversation that, you know, just getting the semiconductors manufactured in the country itself is one big significant step, as we all know. So that's great. I think it'll be hard to then continue to ship all these chips to Southeast Asia and get them packaged, or even have PCBs coming from there, whether it's China or Southeast Asia. So I would be a huge fan of at least allocating some amount of that funding to build out the end-to-end supply chain for some parts of it, for packaging, semiconductor packaging and PCBs, so we can do the entire value stream in the country. So I'd be excited to see how that actually moves, because I think at least doing that in pockets for some parts of the chip industry itself would be really good. And so we're gonna work with Ronnie and his team to see how we can play a part in that and figure out how to create a part of that funding for an end-to-end value chain. So I was excited to see you supporting that, and we think that's a really good idea.
Thanks, Revathi. Three quick things. One, we're gonna be putting out, at the same time we put the application out, we're gonna put out a strategy paper. Because we don't have enough money to do everything that everyone wants us to do. So I wanna be crystal clear about what we must do. And when that comes out, you'll see there's a section on packaging specifically, and there's a section on the supply chain. Yeah. So cool. That's point one. Point two is, I want America to be the first country in the world, hopefully the only country that has leading edge production and packaging and advanced memory in our country.
Yeah.
And certain pieces of the upstream providers. So we have a pretty clear vision for what we're trying to achieve, which leads me to my third point. I have now this, I'm building a team, the CHIPS program office. The guy that runs that is a fellow named Mike Schmidt, the chief investment officer, Todd Fisher, guy in charge of strategy, Dan Kim. I would love to introduce them to you.
Okay.
You know, Ronnie was with us. He's at the White House now. He's fabulous. But I would like you to talk to my team to like talk about what the supply chain should look like. So if you're up for it, I'll connect you to them.
Yeah, that would be great. We're definitely up for it. I think that's the perfect vision. We're fully supportive of that, Secretary Armanda.
Thanks.
Michael?
Thanks very much. And thanks, Secretary Armanda, for being with us today and taking the time. I was struck by your comment about the need to improve the analytics and the fact that, you know, you've talked to some CEOs that have told you they struggle with that in their own companies. And the members of the Express Association of America, my association, are probably the most information intensive companies in the world. And I can tell you, they sometimes, you know, have to really dig deep to get information on supply chain. So I noted that this was a kind of major issue raised in the GEO study that came out earlier this month about the struggle to get good data on supply chains and how that's one of the challenges that the government is facing. So one, I'd be interested in your reaction to that report. But the second thing is, I guess I wanted to make the point that I think for you, for the government to really engage in this process successfully, there has to be a tremendous amount of direct work with the private sector. You need to have the private sector around the table when you're actually drafting some of these documents for efforts like the IPEF and others. And as Jeff pointed out, the data sharing is an important priority. I think there's a lot of expertise on this committee that could do that job. But that type of input has to really be built in, I think, to the trade agreement work that you're going to be conducting over the next couple of years.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we are doing that. But we can come back to you. And if you have specific ideas, I'm happy to follow up. Certainly in the IPEF, we're doing a massive amount of private sector engagement. I know Grant and his team in the process of setting up the supply chain office. We've just received some money for the Commerce Department to set up a supply chain office. We're going to be coming to you, and already are, like, extensively to get your guidance on how we best use those monies. So I couldn't agree more.
Thanks, Michael. Rainer?
Hi there, Secretary Armando, nice to see you again.
We've all known each other for a year, you could start, you can really, someone just needs to call me Gina.
Okay, we'll let the next person who's asking a question tackle that one. But I'll come back to the topic of India, which I find fascinating. Throughout my career, I've been wanting to grow our exposure there, and it's been an enigma. It's the potential that's always 1 year out. It's always the next year, and we never seem to pierce it. But I do think things are changing. And I want to start off with that strategically from a business perspective, and you probably look at this geopolitically. You know, India is a huge opportunity for the world, and India has a huge opportunity for itself here over the next, I would say, decade for sure, but I'd want to front load that and say the next 5 years. I do believe that we are at an inflection point as a world economy where there is a need for a viable hedge to China for all the reasons that I think we're familiar with. And my concern would be, and as you're speaking with your counterparts there, that the inflection point is now because the supply chains are being diversified as we speak. The monies are flowing now, and they're not flowing to India as much as they should. When we look at the potential of India, when we look at the educational levels, when we look at the labor pool, when we look at the potential local market, I mean, there's so many reasons that you would want to, if you're going to diversify your supply chain out of China, to invest in India. And unfortunately, it doesn't appear that India has yet reached the conclusion that they need to be open for business. And the monies are flowing to Vietnam, they're flowing to Malaysia, to some degree for high tech, to Singapore. And those are all great economies, but ultimately they don't have the local market, nor do they have the depth and the competitiveness in the labor pools. So as we interact with India, and I'll also say, you know, we have 5,000 associates in India. They're, you know, some of the best we have in the world, whether that's in digital, biomanufacturing. So, I mean, the talent is there. This is an enormous opportunity here from a number of angles. And my worry is pace, because once you build something in another country, it's going to take another decade for you to start over again.
Yeah, so I did, I don't, a lot of people have their hands up, so I'm going to be brief. Listen, I agree with everything you just said. Both that India has more to like than, say, Vietnam or Indonesia, for all the reasons you said, and also that the pace matters. I suppose the one thing that I would like to follow up with you on, and I will follow up with you on separately, is to get into the details of your specifics around how they aren't doing enough of what they need to do at pace. As I said, I'm going the second week of March. I'm taking about a dozen CEOs with me. I'm spending an enormous amount of time on India, because I'm with you. You know, I think there's a big supply chain opportunity. What I'm trying to do, and what I would ask this group for help with, I mean, I will follow up with you specifically, you know, on Danaher, but everyone here, you know, Jeff and Ursula, I'll say this. Get into the details of what you think we need in India to unlock this. Because we're working at the government-to-government level. Biden's spending a lot of time with Modi. I'm spending a lot of time with my counterpart and the finance minister. We just announced that huge deal with Boeing yesterday. I really feel, and I don't think I'm being naive, they actually want to do the right thing more than any time in the past. They see the writing on the wall with China and the opportunity before them. Yes, the politics are challenging and such, but I think we all have to, because of their size, because of the education, because they're an ally and the whole thing, we have to get really serious about putting in place a plan to make this a reality. So any details this group can share with me, quite frankly, even before I go over in a few weeks, around specifically what we should be trying to achieve would be helpful.
Understood, Gina.
Thanks, Brandon. Revathi, you had a follow-up?
I have a quick follow-up, and I'm going to give Willie the time because I think he came before me. But just on India, I'd say Rainier, like I've spent my whole career trying to figure out how to do business in India and also find a way to make money while you do it and do it in a way that makes sense. So we are in a moment in time that seems interesting. So just because you're going there, I would put a plug in, Secretary Raimondo, is how they create the supply chain is super important, because what we're seeing is building the supply chain with continued dependency on China doesn't seem to make a whole lot of sense. But that seems to be the only way to do it, to accelerate, the progress towards building an end-to-end supply chain. So for US companies who are trying to compete there, again, we'll end up in the same situation where it's hard to compete because you're building dependency and you're doing it through companies that have been based out of China and funded out of there. And that doesn't reach the end objective of, you may, you know, quicken the pace of building the supply chain, but building an independent supply chain may not be the outcome that they get. And I have been working with them and making sure they understand our point of view in this, particularly as we look at specific work in building the supply chain. But it's just a little plug I would put out there that it would be great for American companies to help educate, which we're trying to do, to say, how do you do this? And so I'll just put a plug in for that conversation, Secretary Raimondo.
Thank you.
Willie?
Hi, Gina. Thank you for joining us. And let me give you a couple of data points vis-a-vis India, because during the pandemic, I interviewed a number of Indian pharma companies who had been kind of driven out of the API business because of low-cost competition from China. They are starting to bring that back. But to Reiner's point around, are they open for business? Okay, one of the examples that I always found very striking was, if you look at the ports, and Gene can probably be much more fluent on this, you know, a large amount of ocean-borne cargo destined for India is transshipped at Colombo in Sri Lanka, just because people don't want to have to deal with the bureaucracy. I mean, I think that's an example of emblematic. It's like, I don't want to get stuck in Indian port. I'm going to drop this off at Colombo and, you know, you transship it and deal with it there. And that just adds another layer of complexity in supply chains. We're seeing a little more, for example, direct liner service from Indian ports to East Coast to US, but it's indicative of the type of problem that, you know, they really need to cut through all that bureaucracy. And as Reiner says, really open for business. So just a couple of observations.
Thank you.
Let's see if there's others. Anybody else have Indra.
Gina, good morning. I remember about 15 years ago when Manmohan Singh was in power as prime minister, he set up a task force in the United States of all the diaspora, the CEOs and leaders, and said, tell us what we have to do in the government to remove all the barriers to increase FDI to $100 billion. And he gave us 6 or 7 verticals and said, you report directly to me and my job is to remove these barriers. I think it's time to reopen that because we had a direct line to Manmohan Singh. We had a list of exactly what Willie was talking about, the bureaucracy that holds us back and holds both countries back. And he went about addressing each one of them systematically with the right ministries. But if we don't get highly specific, it will be lots of conversations and exactly what Rayner said, this will just go on and on. So that's the first point. The second issue is, go ahead, you want to say something, Gina?
No, I just, highly specific is the way to go. Do you still have the work?
I may have it in my files. I'll dig it out.
Okay, thank you. All right,
it was quite extensive and I think it covered 6 or 7. It included regulation that has to be removed, the octroi issue between states, to move for movement of trucks. It covered everything and he addressed each one of them very fast. The second is that to deal with India, and I had the same frustrations running PepsiCo, and I see it today too. The thing is, I think our State Department and the Commerce Department have to come together and talk about where does India stand in the pecking order versus true partnership versus partnership based on who's in power. I've heard enough from the India side which says, does the US really want a partnership with us? Because if we really want a partnership with India, then our defense actions have to sort of reflect that. And I got a year full on various issues, which I won't go into now. And I didn't have an answer because I didn't know any details behind it. But I think the conversation that you have with them when you go to India might want to link our national security and defense strategy and defense partnerships with commerce. The two don't go together. It feels like commercial relationships are going to be transactional, but the true strategic partnership is not going to follow. And so that's been the area where I've had trouble answering questions clearly. And that's something you might want to think about.
In the interest of time, I won't respond except to say you're exactly right. And I do have a dialogue going on that dimension.
Gina, do you have time for one more question?
Yeah, I see Jason's
going to say that. Thank you, Jason.
Yeah, just very quickly, we've got operations throughout India. And on the transportation side, one thing to be aware of is infrastructure is a challenge. It's a challenge to move lots of volume across long distances in India. So it's just something to watch out for in an area that's going to be important if the supply chain is to develop more.
Thanks, Jason. And Gina, I would just add one other thing in my experience, which is, China invested very heavily to create ecosystems across industries where you could just plug in at arm's length and, get the technical and manufacturing and logistics support you needed. Since India doesn't have that, foreign direct investment is going to be pretty important. And as you know, they have a number of restrictions in different industries on owners. How much can a foreign company own in a partnership or a JV or a company that does business in India? And it's worth, scrubbing through all those to make sure that some of those aren't severe impediments to the development of a supply chain that spans both nations.
Yes, I appreciate that. I'm going to talk to Grant and you, Jeff, and Ursula, but it might make sense to have this group work specifically on an India strategy, because it is Revathi's volunteer to chair that, I just see. Because it's a big deal. I think there is a moment now, the devil's in the details, like Indra was saying. So anyway, I'm out of time now, but I think I might do that. It puts some definition around your assignment, because around this table, we have so much experience and I don't want to recreate the wheel. You know, some of you have done work in the past. And there's definitely a link to national security. And we're getting there on that, Indra, that we are getting there on that. So for all those reasons, I think I'm going to come back to you and ask you to do a focus on supply chain in India.
Great.
I think we need to...
Any last comments? I wanted to thank you for...
No, I just want to say thank you. We've got, you know, administration officials lined up to come talk to your subcommittees. I hope that will be useful, you know, talking about chips, workforce development, critical minerals. Parenthetically, critical minerals seems that more and more people are talking about it to me more regularly. So I hope that's valuable for you to hear on a more granular level, the work that's happening in the administration. And look, my ask of you, back to, I think, Michael's point, we're putting before you these administration officials to tell you, this is how we're thinking of chips. This is how we're thinking of critical minerals. Weigh in on it, right? Like the whole point of us telling you what's going on the inside is for you to say, have you thought about this? You've got it all wrong on that. You should be focused here. So I hope that those are useful. If we're putting the wrong people in front of you, let us know so we can get the right people in front of you. There's a huge amount of supply chain work happening all across the government, not just in the Commerce Department. We are the tip of the spear. So I just say, you know, thanks for your work. The reward for good work is more work. We're going to be doing a lot of work in the next 2 years in supply chains. And I suppose my goal and desire is to pull this group more into the details of the administration's work so that everything we do in the DOD, or most of what we do in the DOD, in DOT, et cetera, not just in commerce, has your hands on it, you know, so you can weigh in on the work that's done. So with that, I just want to say thank you so much. Nice to see you.
Secretary Raimondo, I want to, on behalf of the committee, I want to thank you for your leadership and support, and especially as a citizen, for asking our government and your colleagues to dive into details that will produce actions. You've had that focus since I first met you, and it's the only way to make change. And you know, I for one will sleep better at night knowing you're pushing that hard for that kind of detail. Thank you.
Very nice to say that. Let's keep going. Appreciate it.
Thank you,
Grant. I'm going to introduce Mitch. Okay.
Yeah, please. And I know the senior advisor has a hard stop, and so I wanted to apologize to him for the All secretary's right. portion going over a bit, but over to you, Jeff, and we really appreciate the senior advisor joining. Thanks so much.
Yeah, of course. So Mitch Landrieu, thanks for joining us. Mitch
hey,
is
Jeff.
Mitch is the senior advisor to the President and White House Infrastructure Coordinator. I'll just do a quick bio. Mitch is responsible for coordinating the implementation of the historic bipartisan infrastructure law, including the most significant and comprehensive investments in roads, bridges, rail, transit ports, airports, safe water, clean energy, and high-speed internet in generations. He served as the 61st mayor of New Orleans from 2010 to 2018. When he took office, the city was still recovering from Hurricane Katrina and in the midst of the BP oil spill. He kickstarted the city's recovery by fast-tracking over 100 projects and securing billions in federal funding for schools, hospitals, parks, and critical infrastructure. Under his leadership, New Orleans is widely recognized as one of the nation's great comeback stories. And there's one other thing that I'll add. He's the author of the New York Times bestseller called In the Shadow of Statutes, A White Southerner Confronts History, which recounts his personal journey confronting the issue of race and institutional racism that still plagues America. Mitch, thanks for joining us today. We look forward to your update.
Jeff, thank you so much. I appreciate that. And I want to apologize at the beginning because I have a hard stop in about 6 minutes because I have to be do a bunch of media hits for a big announcement that we're about to make. But I wanted to, first of all, thank all of you for your input. I was able to listen into the conversation that you had about India, and I couldn't agree more. And Secretary Raimondo, as you know, is just a superstar and a champion. She has been a fantastic partner for the president and me and everybody else on this team. I'm really overwhelmed working in this White House because we are all part of a much larger mission. And I've never been involved with a group of people that work so closely together and that are so intent on bringing in folks that know more than us about this. And all of you on this call fit into that category. And so when Secretary Raimondo says, please weigh in, please let us know. We wouldn't be asking you if we didn't care. We may not all get to yes on everything that we're talking about, but we are constantly seeking input from the private sector, from our local partners, from labor, from the faith-based community, for not-for-profits, to make sure that at least we have good spatial awareness of all the issues out there when we begin to make determinations about what to recommend to the president in terms of how the country can move forward. So let me just kind of give you the really 40,000 foot view about this. And I'm sure you've heard this before from Brian Deese and from Gina. What we're engaged in here is a cross-cutting strategy across infrastructure, clean energy, the Inflation Reduction Act, the CHIPS Act, to build an industrial policy that builds an economy from the bottom up and the middle out, as you've had the president, you've heard the president say, but in all of that, to create a supply chain that we actually can rely on when things get tough. And COVID has demonstrated the weakness of what the world's position is vis-a-vis China and other countries that we've relied on. And that we don't really want to have to do anymore. And so when you think about the CHIPS bill, Gina's got that piece that she's moving in place. John Podesta and his team are working on building an entire new clean energy economy, which we all know is necessary and important. And I have the infrastructure piece, but all of them fit together as different parts of one overarching strategy is to have America become the manufacturing hub of the world to the extent that we possibly can. And so $1.2 trillion, the money gets to the ground two ways. One, it goes directly to the governor through funnels that have been set up since Ronald Reagan has been in office to invest in all of the different platforms that I'll tell you about in a minute. The other way it gets to the ground is through competitive grants that mayors and other governmental entities propose to us to, again, make things happen in all of the different categories. The 375 programs in this bill, but essentially they fall in about 14 different categories that were spoken about a little bit earlier. Roads, bridges, airports, ports, waterways, all critically important to building a really stable, reliable supply chain. Most of that stuff is going through the Department of Transportation, some of it through the Army Corps of Engineers. And then you have making sure that we have access to high-speed internet. Everybody knows how critically important that is to the supply chains. A lot of that is being run out of the Department of Commerce through something called the BEAD program, but the FCC is involved in that. We have the Agriculture Department involved in that, but essentially that is to make high-speed internet ubiquitous. So for example, that farmers can really aggressively participate in precision agriculture as they're helping develop the supply chains in that area. The other whole part of that is the clean energy economy, which just goes from soup to nuts. So today we're announcing that we've made significant headway towards the president's commitment to lay down 500,000 electrical vehicle charging stations because Tesla and Ford and GM and all these other folks have finally come to the table to make sure that we have one interoperable, you know, charging machine that everybody can plug into without having 15 different ways, you know, to juice the car up and to reduce range anxiety. Of course, that's critically important, but it's only a small part of electrifying, you know, the automotive fleets. One of them is massive investments in batteries, the private sector, as we all knew they would, once we sent a market signal, started moving into this space in a big way, and every auto manufacturer in the country is now beginning to manufacture batteries that are going to hopefully keep up with the pace and the demand. But as Gina said before she got off the call, you can't do any of that stuff without critical minerals. and mining those minerals. And then you get into the issue of permitting and how you make all of this stuff happen. And so we're in the business of trying to figure out how to do all of that stuff. We're in constant communication with all the folks along that supply chain. The other piece y'all have talked about a little bit earlier, we had a kind of bottleneck at our ports. Some of this early investment went directly to a lot of the ports. Every time you have new money going into old wineskins, you find out where the holes are and you know where the problems are. I think we're seeing those things more clearly now, and we're making sure that we do that. And then finally on freight, a lot of money trying to make sure that we shore up that portion of our supply chain. And then finally, using products that are made in America to restore the nation's manufacturing base. You know, the general rule was made in America, and then there were lots of exceptions. The exceptions became the general rule. I call that Swiss cheese. We want to get back to cheddar, American cheddar, where the general rule is met with very, very few exceptions, with an understanding for scale and scope and size and timing and all of that stuff. And so we have our hands on the wheel. These things are being pushed down to the ground through the governors and because they're the ones that are spending 90% of this money. But we are in constant communication with the folks that are actually delivering these products, make sure that they're synced up and making sure that we're achieving the goals that the president said. And there's a lot of evidence that this is coming out the way that it was intended and the way that it was in plan. But 12.1 million jobs in 2 years is more than any presidential administration has created in 4 years in the history of the country, lowest unemployment rate. You guys have been following the economy as well as anybody else. Inflation looks like it's easing. Over the past 7 months, it's gone down, but we're not out of the woods yet. And of course, you know, the big idea is that we have to meet this inflection point, as one of you said earlier, with resolve and determination and with a persistence to actually move America into a spot where we're in more control than we have been in the past, given the fact that we're going to continue to have these catastrophic, you know, climate events and also these geopolitical events that you can't control, like the unprovoked war from Russia in the Ukraine, which upsets the supply chain in a dramatic way and then leaves you holding the bag if you don't have other alternatives, or the space that we're in energy. So I feel like we've made great progress. We have a long way to go. Got a lot more work to do, but as all of you should know by now, the president has really assembled a fantastic cabinet. And we work together all the time. I have coordinated 16 separate cabinet level meetings because one of my jobs is to herd the cats, make sure all the different agencies are speaking together, working together, talking together, singing off of the same page of the same hymn book, if you will, so that we get the execution side of this right and make sure that the government shows up and tries to become flexible. The final piece is this: there's a real focus here on innovation, entrepreneurship, research and development, giving us the capacity actually to lead again rather than to follow. All of us are in that hunt. And as I said, when I started, Secretary Raimondo has just been a champ, and her partnership has been just, you know, fantastic in what she and her team over at Commerce have been able to produce. And I know that she couldn't do it without y'all's help, y'all's counsel, y'all's advice. So please give it. Please give us your constructive feedback. Help us be better and help us achieve the president's goal of building a better America. With that, I've got to sign off. Thank y'all so much. I look forward to, if you guys have any questions, if y'all funnel them through there, we'll try to get them back to you. And I apologize for having to jump off, but I have a hard stop at this time. Thank you so much. And it was great talking to you.
Thank you, Mitch.
All right.
Grant, do we have DOE or are we going to take a break?
I think we're taking a break at this time. Heather will correct me if not.
That is correct. Thank you, Grant.
Okay, so we have 15 minutes. So Eastern time, let's reconvene at 12:20.